shift happens. Change is all around us. Your company, your job, and your career are under threat from constant change. Change is bad. Change hurts. Change is a threat. It makes us frantic and frenzied and stressed. How do we deal with it? How do we survive it? Maybe we don't. Maybe there's another way. Maybe, just maybe, instead of trying to insulate ourselves and trying to survive the storm of change, we could take a different approach. Perhaps the best way to thrive in the face of change is to embrace it. Change is good. Change is an opportunity. Change is a chance to evolve, to grow, to get better and faster and more profitable. Survival is not enough.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Survival is Not Enough: Zooming, Evolution, and the Future of Your Company by Seth Godin. Read by the author.
Evolution is a fact, not a theory. Here's what Charles Darwin said.
As many more individuals of each species are born than can possibly survive, and as consequently there is a frequently recurring struggle for existence, it follows that any being, if it vary, however slightly, in any manner profitable to itself, under the complex and sometimes varying conditions of life, will have a better chance of surviving, and thus be naturally selected. From the strong principle of inheritance, any selected variety will tend to propagate its new and modified form. If we look to long enough periods of time, geology plainly declares that all species have changed, and they have changed in the manner which my theory requires, for they have changed slowly and in a graduated manner. I can see no limit to this power in slowly and beautifully adapting each form to the most complex relations of life.
Companies that can evolve slowly and constantly will triumph. As Darwin said,
natural selection can act only by taking advantage of slight successive variations. She can never take a leap, but must advance by the shortest and slowest steps.
In fact, no winning strategy lasts forever.
No fixed law seems to determine the length of time during which any single species or any single genus endures.
And finally, most companies will disappear. As Darwin wrote,
more individuals are born than can possibly survive. A grain in the balance will determine which individual shall live and which shall die, which variety or species shall increase in number and which shall decrease, or finally become extinct.
It's 3 a.m. and it's hot. I can't sleep. My laptop can't reach the internet through the overburdened phone system here at the Cleveland Holiday Inn. Frustrated, anxious, and exhausted, I jump in my car and drive the deserted streets of northern Ohio. Around the corner, I pass a Kinko's. The lights are on. They're always on. I walk in to find hundreds of thousands of dollars of electronics, all just waiting for me. Color copiers, fax machines, and an entire room full of fast computers with a T1 connection to the internet. 5 minutes and $20 later, I've checked my mail and printed out a memo. Time to get some sleep. But I can't get to sleep. I sit up for hours, wondering about that Kinko's. How did Kinko's grow from one tiny store in California all the way to an all-night home office in Cleveland? Turns out there were 8 within 16 miles of my hotel. It took a couple of decades, but the company grew and changed and expanded, almost like an organism, spreading across the country until it had filled every niche it could find. At the same time that Kinko's was growing, dozens of its competitors were silently shrinking, disappearing, becoming extinct. Look at the development of any business, and it's bound to be surprising. Surprising in how unplanned, irregular, and random it is. Some businesses grow and ooze and morph and expand. Others reach a certain spot and freeze. Why do some companies thrive while other companies, though similar, fade away? I knew that there must be a pattern and a dynamic behind all this apparent chaos, but I was having trouble finding it. I've been fascinated with the work of Charles Darwin for a long time, and it occurred to me that companies were very much like species. They were changing and evolving right before our eyes. However, unlike animals, companies fret about this change so much it makes them miserable. Why is there so much pain in our business lives? It's almost as if people were taking Charles Darwin at his word, focusing on survival of the fittest, instead of something more than that. If all you do at work is hope to survive, your day can't be much fun. We're all working too hard, putting in more hours than we'd like, nervous about the future, uncertain about our roles and our goals. We work too hard to hope for mere survival. Our goal must be to thrive and prosper, not just get by. Darwin writes extensively about extinction. We don't want to grapple with the idea that our company is about to become extinct. No one wants to become extinct, but the alternative, change, is hard. Going through all of the uncertainty and hassle to barely survive, or worse, become extinct, doesn't seem fair. We don't know how to talk about change and evolution. We know it's here, and it's real, and it's essential, and it's painful, but we don't have the words for it. I believe that there's a goal beyond survival, that we can actually thrive and find joy in working with all the chaos that surrounds us, that we can look forward to change and turbulence as an opportunity to increase our success. My hope is that this program will give you the words to describe these phenomena as well as an understanding of how they work. There is no secret spell or closely guarded incantation. The solution is written down everywhere you look, from the park to the zoo to the checkout at your local grocery store. And the idea that evolution can work in business is not news either. Jack Welch and GE have been doing it for years and will be happy to teach you about it. So why doesn't everyone use this successful approach? Because we have a genetic reflex to avoid change. The secret of this program is that your success is not going to be due to your plan. It's the process you use that matters. I'm proposing a pretty radical way of thinking about business, but one that's nothing new to an evolutionary biologist. As a result, there are a lot of oddball terms and occasional side trips to go on as you listen to these words. I hope you'll bear with me, because the end result is a totally different set of glasses you can use to look at your job, your career, your company, and even the companies you invest in. Most of us view change as a threat, and survival is the goal. Change is not a threat, it's an opportunity. Survival is not the goal, transformative success is. It's thrilling if you give it a chance. This program contains an idea about ideas, an idea virus about change, one I hope you will find worth spreading. One of my favorite entrepreneurs is a guy named Paul Orfalea. Paul is brilliant and quite successful, but he's unbelievably modest and also very honest about his shortcomings. Paul is profoundly dyslexic. He didn't learn how to read until he was well into elementary school and did nothing in high school that would be associated with the idea of success. He went to college but didn't care an awful lot about his classes. It was the perfect background for an entrepreneur. Paul started a little copy shop. So little, he had to wheel the machine outside to make room for customers on his college campus. He sold pens and papers and made copies. That store grew to become Kinko's, a chain with more than 1,000 outlets that he was able to sell for more than $200 million to an investment group. The secret to Kinko's success is disarmingly straightforward. My reading was still poor and I had no mechanical ability, so I thought that anybody who worked for me could do the job better, Paul explains. He set up a unique co-ownership structure that let him grow the business with more flexibility than a franchise could offer. The end result is that for years, Kinko's stores were partly owned by someone local. Paul described his job to me this way. I just go from store to store, see what they're doing right, and then tell all the other stores about it. By allowing local entrepreneurs to make millions of low-cost experiments every year, Just 3 per day per store gets you to that level. And then communicating the successful ones to the other stores, he was able to set the process in motion that led to that all-night store I found in Cleveland. The Cleveland store wasn't part of a specific plan, but it was very much the outcome of a specific process. Very little specialized knowledge is required to open a copy shop, yet Kinko's dramatically outpaced every other competitor by reinventing what a copy shop was every single day. Kinko's did not have a patented new technology. Instead, it had a posture about change that treated innovations and chaos as good things, not threats. The more successful Kinko's got, the more likely it was to get job applications and co-venture deals with people who made the company even more successful. The more Kinko's stores there were, the more likely it was that people would seek one out. The better Kinko's did, the more successful it became. Kinko's became a success. Working there was fun because the company attracted people who could compound its growth. Kinko's stopped worrying about surviving and enjoyed the ride. It's interesting to see that since the takeover of Kinko's by an investor group...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.